This is a great privilege for me. I've been fascinated with this topic for many years. And, you know, it's only appropriate that the makers of a movie on fibromyalgia would have the name Acres at the end. But I want to tell you, I heartily endorse not only what the film showed, but what you heard Denise talk about. We don't have opportunities to really get into why the stuff she said works, but I'm going to touch on it as briefly in the time that we have. There's a little disclaimer, and that is there really are only two drugs that are officially approved. Most of the medications that we'll talk about are off-label. It's sort of like this little dog. He wants to go down that path, and you know he's going to do anything it takes. If the path is unapproved, we're going to go down there anyway because there's a lot we can do beyond what's been officially approved. Nevertheless, the official approval has made a big difference, and you heard that, in terms of getting it scientifically validated and looked at and thought about, and it's been very useful, the pharmaceutical indications. I'm going to introduce this in a broader way than just fibromyalgia by talking about two different kinds of pain. In the past, we used to talk about acute pain versus chronic pain. And chronic pain is a very different entity than just prolonged acute pain. You have to treat them differently. But even more useful is this distinction, which is nociceptive pain. Nociceptive pain is the kind of pain that's out here in the tissue. Things like arthritis and surgery, trauma, things that have caused damage out in the tissues, that's nociceptive pain. That's the kind that often responds well to things like anti-inflammatories and opiates. On the other side of the equation, you have neuropathic pain. And neuropathic pain is often that which is caused by nerve damage, where the nerve itself, so out here you'll have a pain generator, signal is carried by a nerve into the central nervous system. In the case of neuropathic pain, the nerve is damaged, hyperexcitable, and that becomes the pain generator. But there's more to the neuropathic story. And so we'll see things, for example, like diabetic neuropathic pain and shingles and so on, where you have the damaged nerve being the pain generator. Now, fibromyalgia and a lot of the pain that I deal with at a clinical pain clinic is in this mixed state where you can often have elements of both. So we'll have things like chronic low back pain or neck pain or fibromyalgia, where it may have been kicked off by something where there was damage. But then you have what basically are like neuropathic elements that keep it going. The drugs that work, well, first of all, neuropathic pain, there are two parts. Okay, one is, now this is classical broad neuropathic pain we're talking about. You know, this lesion in the nervous system that's causing damage. You don't have that with fibromyalgia. But the second part of neuropathic pain is this dysfunction of the nervous system where it hypersensitizes and starts over-responding to all kinds of stimuli. Things hurt that shouldn't hurt. You put the bed covers over the foot of the diabetic and just touch hurts. That's called allodynia, where stuff hurts that shouldn't hurt. That's the second part of neuropathic pain. And we heard Dr. Light talk about the fact that, you know, usually pain has some benefits. It keeps you from hurting things, from damaging things. But neuropathic pain really serves no useful purpose, and it's usually chronic kind of pain. Now, the reason I bring up this distinction, two reasons, is this. It's this second part of neuropathic pain, the dysfunction, the hyperexcitability, is sort of the characteristic of the way fibromyalgia works. And in fact, the medications that work for neuropathic pain are these. Rather than opiates, which don't work very well for neuropathic pain, or anti-inflammatories, you know, the arthritic pills, they don't work very well for neuropathic pain, nor do they work very well for fibromyalgia. The things that work for neuropathic pain, anticonvulsants, called neural stabilizers. Let me just back up for a second. It seems kind of funny, you know, anticonvulsants, what's that all about with pain? If you kind of think about it, seizures, convulsions, are a twitchy nervous system that's over-responding to stimuli. You get exposed to bright light, and everything goes bananas. And what the anticonvulsants do is normalize the nervous system responses to stimuli. Same thing is true of pain. They work nicely for neuropathic pain because it reduces that over-responsiveness of the nervous system to pain stimuli. Antidepressants, I put them in quotes, because these drugs work whether or not depression is there, or whether or not an anxiety disorder is there. I'll show you why in just a moment. And sometimes topical agents, and then some other neurotransmitter modulators. We're not going to get into those much because they're kind of more frontline, but I'll touch on what they are as we go through this. And neuropathic pain, like fibromyalgia, frequently can be resistant to treatment and requires combinations of these medications. Now, it's not at all about medication, but the medication helps us to know what are the mechanisms involved. And often we need combinations of these kind of things to make it work. The same thing is true for fibromyalgia. Now, not all that aches chronically is fibromyalgia. And this very complex-looking diagram will tell you a little bit about how a doctor thinks in making a diagnosis for you if you have widespread muscle pain. Up here, myalgia, that's muscle pain. That's the myalgia of fibromyalgia. Over on this side of the equation are things that are inflammatory. And so what do? Well, we look at tests, blood tests, like the sedimentation rate that goes up in inflammatory things like rheumatoid arthritis or lupus. Okay, and we may look at a muscle enzyme, this creatine kinase that goes up in inflammatory muscle diseases like polymyositis. We may even look at the electromyogram that can show some abnormal signals. And you'll notice over here we ask about weakness. Now, if the muscle disorder with a lot of pain has a lot of weakness, not just it feels weak because it hurts, but, you know, you can't get out of a chair, you can't climb stairs, it's hard to lift anything, not because of pain, but because of muscle weakness, then we're going to be looking more at this side of the equation and diagnoses like polymyositis. If there's high inflammatory markers but no weakness, we may be looking at things like polymyalgia rheumatica, which is an inflammatory condition you see in older folks, responds to things like steroids and the drugs you use for rheumatoid arthritis and lupus and the like. Okay, so a couple of tests are going to tell us, is there any inflammatory story? On the other side, where you have a normal sedimentation rate, now we're going to be looking for tender points. If there are no tender points, so here's a widespread muscle pain, no inflammatory markers, and no tender points. We may be looking at certain endocrine things. One illustration would be severe vitamin D deficiency. It is surprising how many people with fibromyalgia symptoms have severe vitamin D deficiency, which can cause bony and muscle pain. One question that we always ask is, do you get out in the sun much? And people with chronic pain often don't get out in the sun. If you don't get enough sun, you're likely to be vitamin D deficient. And we will treat that whether or not it's the primary issue. But it gets confusing because a lot of fibromyalgia patients are vitamin D deficient. And so we need to deal with that. Now, here's our little decision tree. If we've got no inflammatory markers and we've got these tender points that you heard about, even severe low thyroid function can do that. So we always do a test for thyroid function. This isn't subtle hypothyroidism. This is a lot of hypothyroid. You don't have to use, you know, tricky tests to find out if it's just a little bit abnormal. This is a lot if you've got widespread pain and fatigue that goes with it. Now, among all these differentials, far and away the most common of widespread muscle pain is going to come down this track. No inflammatory markers, positive tender points, no thyroid disease or subtle thyroid problems, and you're going to end up with fibromyalgia. So the point I'm making is we need to look through a careful analysis. Is this widespread pain really fibromyalgia or something else? There are a few tests that are helpful to rule out other things. The diagnosis you've heard about a number of times, chronic widespread pain, meaning more than 3 months, significantly bothersome, widespread above and below the diaphragm, both sides of the body. And these 11 of 18 tender points. Dr. Light astutely noted, yeah, but that's just kind of drawing a line in the sand so you can do research on this thing. You gotta have some kind of criteria that you can call it fibromyalgia. Those are the American College of Rheumatology criteria. Fairly straightforward. There are two other things I think are very important. One is the sleep abnormality, kind of unrefreshed sleep, and when you actually do sleep tests, a person will lack deep sleep. We'll come back to that. And I think another very important part is often there's a lot of other highly overlapping nervous system hypersensitivity problems. If you don't have that sleep problem and you don't have a lot of these other things, which I'm going to describe, I'm going to be looking for something else as a cause of the chronic widespread pain, even if you have a little bit of tenderness. Now, it's not 100%, but usually the nervous system isn't just over-responding to pain, it's over-responding to a lot of other things as well. Let me give you an illustration. Well, first, you know the tender points. If we were to biopsy, let's take this little spot right here in the middle of the trapezius, and we biopsy that, what are you going to see? Nothing on the usual tests. Now, maybe Al could find some ACE receptors or something. Okay, that's a different deal. But the usual tests, you're not going to see a lot. Because it's not a muscle disease in the sense that we usually think of a peripheral muscle disease. Okay, what's happening, if those of you who do not have fibromyalgia, if you poke on yourself on those spots, you'll find those little spots are places that are just a little more sensitive than all of us. If you did this right now, you poke right here, that spot I described, in the middle of your trapezius, and the amount you push is just enough to blanch your thumb. Okay, that's not hard. Okay, it's a little sensitive. Then you push over here somewhere, and you'll notice this place isn't nearly as sensitive as this place. These are spots that are just a little more sensitive than all of us. But when you have this augmentation, the nervous system over-responding to a pain signal, a little pain stimulus becomes a big pain stimulus. And that's why these spots have been chosen. They're just kind of places that are more sensitive, and so they tell us more. You may well be sore all over the place. And Dr. Light also astutely mentioned, suppose you've got, you know, the unrefreshing sleep and the other hypersensitivity problems and widespread pain, but you've only got 9 tender points. Well, what is that? It's the same thing. But for research, we need to have 11. Okay, now, let's describe what these other hypersensitivity things are. These are very common medical problems. In fact, there are some from studies I did in primary care clinics at the U, some of the most common medical things. For example, if you were to guess of everyone going in to see a gastroenterologist for anything, what the most common diagnosis is that comes out of a GI clinic? Well, that's right, okay, irritable bowel syndrome. Half of everyone going in to see a gastroenterologist has irritable bowel. And another large group have upper GI sensitivity problems, stomach and esophageal sensitivity problems. It's a majority. This is a lot. Well, what is it? This guy named Whitehead did this sort of fascinating study where they took a catheter with a balloon on the end of it and they put it up in the colons of the irritable bowel patients. That's the frowny face. And normals. And I suspect some of these normals are med students or nursing students trying to get a grade, you know, grin and bear this deal. And they start blowing the balloon up and ask them two things. How soon do you feel it, and how much does it hurt? Okay, and so they're slowly blowing this balloon up. Well, the results were rather striking. Over here on this side of the graph are those reporting significant pain, and down here is the volume of the balloon. Now notice, as the balloon, this is normals now, They don't feel a darn thing till you get about 100 cc's, and even above that really doesn't hurt until you get to very high levels that it hurts. But notice what happens with irritable bowel. They feel it immediately. It hurts way too much. And then the nervous system responding to this discomfort sends signals back that cause smooth muscle spasm, and thus you get the diarrhea and the constipation and the bloating. Now, the point that I'm making is irritable bowel, very common, very real disorder. There are no positive tests. I mean, you know, you might put a scope in and see a little spasm, but that was that. Okay, no positive usual tests, the usual kind of clinical tests. It's a central nervous system over-responding to what should be a normal gut stimulus. A little gut stimulus becomes a big stimulus. Fibromyalgia is like irritable bowel of muscle, over-responding to what should be a normal stimulus. Here are a list of very common hypersensitivity problems. Irritable bowel and some of the functional upper GI things. Irritable bladder. It's very similar. The bladder senses the volume of fluid, and a little fluid becomes too uncomfortable and smooth muscle spasm. It's like irritable bowel of the bladder. About 60% of people with IBS have irritable bladder, and fibromyalgia people have more irritable bladder. And there are no positive tests. You look in the bladder, you know, other than spasm, no tests, but a very common problem. Non-cardiac chest pain, most common cause of chest pain, not heart disease, it's this non-cardiac kind. Migraine headaches were mentioned a little earlier. Well, in terms of this sensitivity, think of migraine. Light hurts. Sound hurts. See, stuff hurts that shouldn't hurt. It's a twitchy nervous system over-responding to stimuli. And about 60% of people with fibromyalgia will have headaches. Sometimes the TM joint is a similar thing. It's not that necessarily that the joint is damaged, but it hurts in the muscle there. And people grind their teeth often with fibro. Restless leg syndrome. A little discomfort in the legs, and it's too much. And people have to shake their legs when they go to bed or move around to get rid of it. And that's higher in fibromyalgia. And then, of course, over-responding to pain. And even if you think about it, an anxiety disorder is a twitchy nervous system over-responding to stress stimuli. A little stressor becomes more of a stressor. It's like, you know, everything is just augmented. And if you have one of these things, you're very likely to have one of the others. Fibromyalgia people often will have several of these things. This is why I was saying if you don't have any of these other things, you know, I start getting a little suspicious whether or not this is truly fibromyalgia. Now, how does hypersensitization occur and who is it more likely? We heard some very good stuff from Dr. Light about this. Here's kind of a little sequence. The genetic predisposition. I'll show you two or three genes that have been proven to be abnormal in fibro in a minute. These genetic predispositions tend to cause abnormalities in some of the neurotransmitters. Neurotransmitters are what help one nerve talk to another nerve. Signal comes down this nerve, releases neurotransmitters, stimulates the next nerve to send the signal on. Those neurotransmitters are genetically determined and they're abnormal in fibromyalgia. And genetic predispositions to sleep problems. And then you'll have a triggering event that activates the genetics. And you heard Kathleen talk about that. And that starts off this disordered sensory processing. So even after the triggering event disappears, the nervous system just takes on a life of its own in over-processing signals. Some of the triggering events were mentioned a little earlier, just a quick summary. It could be trauma. So if you're genetically prone to hypersensitize and have some of these neurotransmitter things kind of sitting there latently, and now you have trauma, and the pain goes on and on, particularly if it's kind of undertreated acutely, the nervous system starts hypersensitizing. And then even after the trauma or the peripheral event disappears, the nervous system keeps going. It could also be an infection, a flu-like illness, widespread pain. And the flu has gone on for a while, and then the infection goes away, but the pain carries on. psychological stress. See, this nervous system isn't just responding to pain. It's now over-responding to stress. You've had a period of stress, and it's over-responsive. And now your muscles tighten under stress, and now the pain starts carrying on even after the stressor is gone. Here's a little analogy. The same genetics and predispositions in a person who gets a gastroenteritis, you know, you get a viral infection or a bacterial infection, your bowel is all sensitized and over painful and over-responding, and then the infection goes away, but the IBS takes on a life of its own, even though the trigger event is gone. You begin to see this interesting pattern, and how it shows up for you may depend on what the initial triggering event was. It also depends on your genetics. Let's take a look at the genetics just for a second. Leslie Arnold, good researcher in clinical fibro, identified that family members of fibro patients, even if they don't have the fibromyalgia, tend to be more sensitive when you touch these spots. And they're 8.5 times more likely to get fibromyalgia. So there's a genetics to this, but it's not just one gene. Let me show you 3 or 4 that have been shown, and there's undoubtedly a lot more. Some of the neurotransmitter genes that have been shown to be abnormal. This gene, serotonin transporter, down in a synapse, this is the thing that removes the serotonin from the synapse, gets rid of it. And if it's abnormal and it's being removed too much, then serotonin doesn't work too well. That gene has also been shown to be abnormal in irritable bowel, some anxiety disorders, and vulnerability to stress. There's another one. On the other side of the synapse is this serotonin 2A receptor. So the serotonin comes out and stimulates certain receptors, and this particular one is a problem. The gene for that's abnormal. You see also abnormalities of that receptor in migraine, smooth muscle spasm, irritable bowel, irritable bladder, rain out when you get cold, blue, and white hands, blood vessel spasm, okay, and even in bipolar disorder, problems with that particular receptor. Here's another one. This is a COMT, is the thing that gets rid of norepinephrine and dopamine. If it's abnormal, you get abnormalities in dopamine and norepinephrine, and even genes for these receptors. These are a couple of the receptors for dopamine. All of these have been shown to be abnormal in fibromyalgia. Now, you may not get all of those. You may have one of them. You may have two. You may have three. And how your syndrome shows up may well be, what combination of these genes do you have? Which parts is going to determine? You see, fibromyalgia is a syndrome. It's not one disease. It's a combination of things you can come into from several different paths based on genetic vulnerability and what the triggering events are. Now, I just point out here, serotonin, norepinephrine, and dopamine. So there's abnormalities there. What does that have to do with pain? Well, this next slide shows very briefly how we might answer that. Here out in the tissue would be a pain generator, so trauma, something where you're getting pain out in the muscle. Signal comes in on this nerve into the spinal cord, connects, we call that synapses, with another nerve in the spinal cord that goes up to the brain. And then the point of this is the brain sends signals back down to inhibit the pain. Problems with that inhibitory track can lead to a lot of nervous system hypersensitivity. It's not only inhibiting pain, but inhibiting responses to other stimuli as well. Three key neurotransmitters to the inhibitory track are serotonin, norepinephrine, and dopamine. So if genetically you have problems with those, you often have problems with inhibition. Now, incidentally, those same neurotransmitters are the ones that are often abnormal in things like clinical depression and clinical anxiety disorders. Remember, that's what antidepressants work on. They improve serotonin, norepinephrine, and dopamine function. So even if a person's not depressed, the antidepressant kind of agents can be helpful to raise those transmitters and improve the inhibition for the pain and other things. Now, what we have here then, when inhibition is lacking, the nervous system starts to hypersensitize. This is where the plot thickens, because we have two big problems in fibromyalgia. The first is excessive activation. Now, I'll show you what I mean by that. Right down here in the spinal cord, a little signal's coming in, and there's too much of a signal going up to the brain. There's augmentation. A little signal becomes a big signal. Part of that's inactive inhibition, but it's also because the nervous system just over-responds, and that's down here in the spinal cord. And we've got this inadequate inhibition. Those are two targets, both pharmacologically and non-pharmacologically, that we can go after. Many of the things that Deneen spoke about and the patients spoke about non-pharmacologically affect these neurotransmitters. In fact, I've tossed a little thing that's not in your handout in that shows this in just a moment. Now, what I'd like to do is go down here in the spinal cord. This looks like it's a little technical, but I think if you kind of understand what's going on, how people are thinking about how we might treat this, it's very useful. Okay, so we're going to look now at this synapse. This is where the incoming pain neuron hooks up with the second neuron going up to the brain. Before I leave this, however, here's another little piece. When the nervous system is overactive and a pain signal comes in, not uncommonly, not always, but not uncommonly, you get a signal going back out to the tissue that releases some of those sympathetic nervous system agents that Dr. Light spoke about, and you get blood vessel spasm and muscle spasm, and now that can become a pain generator out in the tissue. Now, that's not the tender points, but it's not uncommon to see trigger points, which are little spastic places that now become a pain generator that kind of contributes to the process. Those little trigger points are different than the tender points of fibromyalgia. I'll come back to that in a moment. So here we are in this synapse. Let me go back for a second. Incoming pain neuron connecting with the second order neuron right there. That's what we're going to be looking at here. Here's the incoming pain signal. Now here's what happens. That pain signal opens some ion channels, okay? We heard about ion channels. These aren't necessarily the ones you heard about, but you see calcium flowing into the nerve, which causes the release of these pain neurotransmitters, the orange things there, things like glutamate and substance P. Those pain neurotransmitters go out into the synapse, and on the other side, they open calcium channels and sodium channels, that's this Na, and the more sodium and calcium that flows into that nerve on the other side, the one going to the brain, the more sodium and calcium that flows in, the more powerful the signal. So what we're ending up with is too much sodium and calcium going in there and firing off that nerve. This is where the anticonvulsants work. We have two kinds. Some of them reduce the influx in flow of the calcium. So a pain signal comes in, and if you're on something like Lyrica or Neurontin, those are calcium-modulating anticonvulsants, the pain signal comes in, less calcium comes in, you get less release of these pain-activating neurotransmitters, glutamate and substance P. So they fall in the synapse, and you don't activate the next neuron as much. Some of the older anticonvulsants, and some new ones, block these sodium channels. For fibromyalgia, the calcium channel agents work better than the sodium channel agents, but sometimes we even add them together. Okay, so just aware of some of that. Now, if the pain is unrelenting and goes on, so now we've got this new process, in a way, where you release more of the substance P that comes over and activates this receptor called NMDA. Don't worry about the details of that. But when that thing is turned on, you get calcium and sodium flowing in all over the place, firing off this neuron. And you get another thing going on that I can't show you very well, But some of these other tissues called glia get activated that produce some inflammation that hypersensitizes things as well. So this is the process going on down in the spinal cord. So we've got several targets we might go after. Incidentally, some newer things coming out will be things that quiet down this glial inflammation or things that block this NMDA receptor. We don't have great stuff to do that just yet, but they're coming down the pipe. In the cerebral spinal fluid. Now, let's talk for a minute about tests that are clearly abnormal in fibromyalgia. There are tests, but they're not the kind of tests you get in the clinical laboratory. For example, if you look at the cerebral spinal fluid, remember substance P? If we went back there for a second, this substance P that's turning on this NMDA and hypersensitizing things. Well, if you look in the cerebral spinal fluid, here are four different studies. Look at that, 3 to 4 times normal. Substance P is high. Glutamate is high. So they're abnormal, okay? Consistently. Here's another thing, and this was alluded to very briefly. If I take Dr. Bateman down here, who has no pain, and inflict pain upon her while she's sitting in a functional MRI scanner. The functional MRI scanner is looking at how your brain functions in responses to stimuli. And I inflict pain upon her, those parts of the brain in green and red will light up. With fibromyalgia folks, you just press on these little tender points that shouldn't hurt, that part of the brain lights up. The brain is sensing the pain objectively, even though it's just a little stimulus. So we've got abnormal neurochemistry proven and the brain over-responding. Here's what you see. In conjunction with this study. Down here is the stimulus intensity to induce pain, and over here is the pain intensity. Here's a normal person at this amount of pressure, and here's the fibromyalgia person. See, it's about 5 times less pressure to induce the same changes in the brain and clinically the pain that you see. You have to double the pressure to get the normal person to experience that much pain. So clearly, there are abnormalities. And there are some other ones that I won't go into right now that show objectively that the nervous system is over-responding to stimuli. Here are some things then that have been shown to be abnormal, usually in the cerebral spinal fluid. That's not easy stuff to measure. You have to do lumbar punctures, and it really varies from down here in the back as to what it is in the brain. So they're not practical tests we're talking about. But you don't have to do the test because if you've got the syndrome, we know these things are abnormal. Here's some things. Low central serotonin function been shown. Dr. Russell down in San Antonio. That also contributes to sleep problems and anxiety when serotonin is low. Low norepinephrine function has been shown. That contributes to pain and fatigue. Low dopamine function. That changes your ability to concentrate and to focus and to enjoy things. And the high substance P and high glutamate. Now, these on the bottom, the high substance P and glutamate, amplify the pain going to the brain. The ones that are lacking are the ones that inhibit the pain signal. Okay, and you can see that the mechanisms are in place here. How do you treat these things? Well, the antidepressants are things that improve these neurotransmitters that improve inhibition, and the anticonvulsants quiet these amplifying neurotransmitters that are too high. There are also things you can do non-pharmacologically that impact this, and this plays into things that came out of the movie. Cognitive behavioral mechanisms. I'm going to talk about briefly about that. Good data that cognitive behavioral interventions help fibromyalgia. Just briefly, remember when Deneen talked about who is in control of me? Is the pain in control of my life or am I in control of my life? An internal locus of control raises serotonin function. She talked about loving relationships and cooperation and support. That's been shown to raise dopamine and endorphins. Exercise, positive excitement, getting turned on to purpose. You remember? working towards something out there outside of yourself, making a difference, getting turned on, excited. Up goes norepinephrine centrally, and dopamine and some of the endorphins. You see, there's reasons for why these subtle ways of thinking and responding can affect these same neurotransmitters. Deep relaxation and meditation techniques improve deep sleep, raise serotonin, reduce some of that sympathetic tone that Dr. Light spoke about. So you begin to see there are a lot of things that you can do separate from medications that help. It may not be enough up front, way up front, when things are bad, without the medication. Sometimes you need the medication to kind of bring the nervous system under control. I'm not talking here about opiates and anti-inflammatories, things that you get addicted to. But some of these medications that kind of normalize nervous system responses, and then as you do this stuff, you may, with a little time, get off those medications. How long you stay on the medications depends on how long you've had the disease, the disorder, because the nerves literally start becoming hardwired to over-respond, and that takes time to reverse, depending on how long you've had it. Early is better. If there are people in your family with subtle symptoms of this, early's the name of the game to prevent this long-term hardwiring wind-up that we've been talking about. So, sense of control, loving relationships, purpose, meditation, very useful techniques, which you can learn through programs of cognitive behavioral interventions, or sometimes on your own. It's some websites that I'm going to give you at the end. What about the sleep problem? Basically, here's a quick course in sleep. There are five stages. Stage one and two are light sleep. Stage three and four, the length of the line is deeper sleep. Stage three and four is deep sleep, and then REM sleep. Deep sleep and REM, that's dream sleep, are very different. Dream sleep, REM sleep is not deep sleep, okay? But when it's during deep sleep that you tend to get a lot of body repair and things like growth hormone secreted. People with fibromyalgia tend to run low growth hormone. There was a study up in Oregon where they gave growth hormone. This is expensive, and it's awkward, it has to be done by injections, but improving the growth hormone did help somewhat with symptoms. But what do you do? Well, instead of giving growth hormone, what do? You restore the deep sleep that's lacking, and then you make your own growth hormone. How do you restore deep sleep? Here's some medications that do it. We did a study using this GHB, that's gamma hydroxybutyrate. That's the date rape drug. It gives you a wonderful deep sleep. Okay? And in treating only with that agent, just restoring the deep sleep, about 30% of people got a good clinical response. You know, nothing else, just sleep. And here are a number of the other agents. There's pregabalin, is Lyrica, that will restore deep sleep. Some of the drugs are called atypical neuroleptics. Those are the ones that block that serotonin 2 receptor. And we use them if a person has bipolar kind of or cyclic mood problems. They really restore deep sleep as well. So anyway, these are things that restore sleep. And non-pharmacologically, there are a number of deep relaxation techniques, simple things. If we had time, I would walk you through these. But before going to bed, deep relaxation techniques restore deep sleep as well. In some of the offer meetings that Dr. Drescher mentioned, we have walked through them. We have these monthly education meetings. We've walked through some of these techniques. Some of them will be on the website. Some of them will probably be coming up in future meetings as well. One other little thing, just a caveat that's important. Most fibromyalgia patients should probably be screened for sleep apnea. It's only about 20% that have it, but if you snore and you wake unrefreshed and are sleepy during the day, sleep apnea is a thing where your airways close off when you breathe and your stress system fires off to get you breathing again. All night long, your stress system is firing off, which causes sensitivity. It's very difficult to treat fibromyalgia if you have untreated sleep apnea. So there's some simple little home tests that can screen for that, but it's well worth considering, particularly if you snore with fibromyalgia. So here are some targets. treatment targets. I'm going to talk about pharmacological for a moment. The anticonvulsants and neural stabilizers that work down there on those calcium and sodium ions that are oversensitive reduce the substance P and glutamate. The deep sleep, with or without medication. The antidepressants, and I might add, some of the older antidepressants, the SSRIs, don't work very well. You really kind of need to have the ones that have the norepinephrine effects for pain. Dual acting, serotonin and norepinephrine tend to work better. And some of the agents like dopamine agonists. Those are the drugs that you use for restless legs. In fact, we're doing a study right now at LifeTree with a dopamine agonist, adding it to these other things. Usually research studies, you have to get off of everything and use one medication. This particular one's a very nice study because we're adding this to whatever antidepressant or anticonvulsant a person's on. Small studies show that that works very nicely to help, but they're small, and this is a larger study. The anticonvulsants and the dopamine agonists may well contribute to improving deep sleep. If present, sometimes the trigger points. Now, these are not the tender points. These are little, I don't know how well you can see this, but you see that little bunched up muscle right in there? That's trigger points. And you can feel them, that you palpate them. You know, they're like little lumps. You press on them and they shoot pain in funny directions. And they don't respond very well to medications. But treating them locally, sometimes injecting them with a local anesthetic and breaking the spasm can be helpful to get rid of a trigger. That's not injecting the tender points, but these, if you have them, some of these little trigger points can be useful. So treatment of fibromyalgia, pharmacological, non-pharmacological. When we do studies, one of the things the FDA wants is what percent of people get a 50% reduction in pain. We have this pain scale, 0 to 10. If any of you have ever been evaluated for pain, you may well have had your 0 to 10, 10 being the worst imaginable pain. If a person has bad pain up here at 8 out of 10, disabling pain, what's being asked is what percent of people would get down to 4 or less, a 50%, which is significant. That's non-disabling pain. And I'm going to just summarize the medications that I just showed you for what percent of people with fibromyalgia get a 50% reduction in pain. Positive pharmacological trials, the anticonvulsants, pregabalin, that's the Lyrica that was first approved. Okay, it's about 30%, so about a third of people get that 50% reduction. With the dual-acting antidepressants, duloxetine is Cymbalta. It's the second drug that got an indication, and it's the same range. About a third of people get a 50% reduction. Remember, that's a different mechanism. Dopamine agonists in this smaller, but not tiny, study where they added this pramipexole, this dopamine agonist, onto the other things. 75% of people further improved. And about 40% had a 50% improvement. That's why we're doing this larger study. And in this one study using this sleep agent, about 30%. Now, you notice there's kind of a consistency here. Asking what percent of people with each of these agents get a 50% reduction? Well, about 30% with the anticonvulsants. About 40% with the dual-acting antidepressants. About 40% with the dopamine agonist, and about 30% with the sleep agent. But remember, you can add them together because these are complementary mechanisms. Some are quieting the augmentation, some are improving the inhibition, some are improving sleep. So it's often kind of thoughtful combinations medically are often what we're after. Here's some things that have not been shown to be very effective. Opiates. Opiates can be useful kind of once in a while for a day, but if you take them chronically, opiates tend to almost make the sensitization worse. And like neuropathic pain, we tend to do better with these agents that quiet nervous system sensitivity instead of just treating the symptom of pain. Steroids don't seem to work. The anti-inflammatory is not very effective. Which medications would we start? Well, it depends. Your genetics and your triggers are going to give different patterns. If a person has a lot of pain with sleep and tingling, you know, nervous sensitivity, the anticonvulsant may be what a doctor chooses. If there's some depression and anxiety that's consistent, maybe an antidepressant would be the first agent. If there's just pain alone, maybe the cyclobenzaprine or tramadol might be considered first. If a person has fluctuating moods or a lot of anger, that's almost impulsive anger, we may want to use an anticonvulsant, maybe one of these atypical neuroleptics first. So it really depends what the rest of the story is as to how the best medical approach might be used. And again, thoughtful combinations often the best. Now, I'm going to show you, just based on data, non-pharmacological treatments, strong, intermediate, and weak data, for what it's worth. Strong evidence, education, being here and understanding the disease. That's why we're going through all this detail for you. The better you understand it has been proven to be very helpful. Gives you a sense of control, handle on it. There's hope. There's things that we can do. Okay? And that's very useful. Cognitive behavioral therapy, I'll show you here in just a moment. Cognitive means ways of thinking about this. Behavioral has to do with techniques I use to change responses. And the paced exercise. Good, strong evidence for those three things. Here's some with some evidence. It's not necessarily that they don't work, but not as much robust data. Okay, hypnosis, massage, hot baths, particularly when you get flares. A hot bath followed by sleep can be very useful. Minimal evidence. Again, doesn't say it doesn't work, but not much evidence for things like nutritional things and acupuncture. Just quickly, a little summary. The data's not, the details are not so important, but notice this is cognitive behavioral therapy alone without medications. See, over half of people are feeling better. Some of it major improvement. It depends on what you do, and here are the elements of cognitive behavioral things that seem to make the most difference. They need to be experiential. Rather than just talking about how to deal with stress, it's involving yourself with things like meditation, visualizing, responding differently, where you experience in your mind doing it the way you would admire someone doing it well. Literally practicing mentally what it's like doing it the new way, more effective than just taught. Self-efficacy oriented. Who's in control of me? Am I in control of me or the disease in control of me? Very important issue. And the ones that the cognitive behavioral things that work better included paced exercise and sleep management. I'm going to kind of sort of finish with a little philosophical issue. I wasn't going to put this in, but the movie made me think that we really ought to talk about this a little more. Who am I? Okay, sometimes it's very easy to start feeling like I am pain. I am fibromyalgia. But the moment you start moving to a new dimension, now the green part is how much pain is present. In the second box, there's still just the same amount of pain. But this sense that pain is here, but it's not me. I'm something much larger than my pain. And you saw that in the movie, the folks that talked about that. Okay, and you even take it to a higher dimension. You remember Deneen's mom, the thing that seemed to really turn things around is when she kind of started getting into some of these spiritual things, which I might add, surveys of fibromyalgia patients, that seems to be very helpful, okay? And where it's sort of, see, the same pain, same amount of pain, but I'm part of something much larger. Not only is the pain not me, but I'm part of something much larger than just me. And you start changing from I need fixing to I'm much more to I'm free and connected. And pretty soon the pain is here, but as you give less attention to the pain, you give less power to the pain. And as you give more attention to who you are at higher levels, you give more power to that and tend to inhibit the pain. I might just add, people ask us all the time, and forgive me for putting this up, people ask, where can you get the cognitive behavioral things addressed to fibromyalgia? Locally, here are three sources. There may be others that we're not aware of. Dr. Drescher and Dr. Noyes have been doing this for years. Dr. Drescher is our moderator here today. The University Pain Clinic, Dr. Okafuji, has this multidisciplinary program doing research on the cognitive behavioral things. Very good program. And then we have a program, Kathy Seegers and I, over at LifeTree. Okay, kind of a group kind of thing where you come for 6 weeks and the like and learn these techniques. Exercise improves the needed transmitters, improves deep sleep, it reconditions the muscles. The more deconditioned the muscles are, the more they hurt. The more conditioned they are, the less they hurt. And you heard some data on that. Many studies confirm the value of that. However, once again, the exercise needs to be very carefully paced. If you can't do much, go walking for 5 minutes. Okay, up to below where it kicks off the pain. And if, after you've done that for a while, go to 10. And then go to 15. And just whatever it takes to get reconditioned. But just slow, and you don't try to overdo it. The pacing is a very important issue. So let me summarize right here. Five important parts to dealing with this. One is treat early and aggressively. Prevent in a person predisposed, genetically predisposed, when some of these things start showing up, bring it under control as early as possible to prevent that hard wiring. Secondly, we talked about some of the neurochemical issues, anticonvulsants, dual-acting antidepressants, dopamine agonists. Treat the sleep well, particularly the deep stages, the carefully paced exercise, and then finally, how to become stress resilient. Where the stress doesn't control me, I do. Okay, so I'm going to stop there and thank you for your attention. Oh, if I may, I apologize. Not in your handout are some very useful websites. Okay, to do some of this on your own, the exercise, the cognitive behavioral, okay, this University of Michigan website is a terrific site, and of course the offer site where the education meetings, I think you can get many of them already online free, and there will be more being added as we go. I'm going to leave this up just for a moment as if you want to write those websites down.
Thank you, Dr. Smith. Our next...
Maybe we need to leave that up there just a second. You mean you couldn't... you couldn't write that big thing down there in 10 seconds? Okay.
Go ahead.
Okay, just go ahead and write those down. I'm sorry, I should have had them in your handout.
While you're copying this information down, I just want to emphasize that when you came in today, there were surveys on the chairs, and we would greatly appreciate if you would take a few minutes and fill that information out. When you leave at the end of the afternoon, there are small tables just outside. Oops.
Whoops.
Thank you. I wasn't paying attention. There are tables just outside the doors with baskets, and if you would place the questionnaires in the baskets as you leave, it would be very helpful in terms of us being able to know who was in attendance today. So hopefully you're able to get this website, and if you don't get the second one, the offer website is a rich source of information. Our final speaker is a person who some years